Judge will lead off for the Seminoles. First pitch strike coming into Mudge. Let's take a look at the starting lineup for Florida State. It's brought to you by Capital One. And Michaela Edenfield, you can't miss her, the catcher. Had a two-run home run. It's just what she does.
And I like her down there in the seventh spot. It takes a little bit of pressure off of having to constantly try to go yard. You're going to get probably better pitches down there than in that four spot.
Second pitch comes in outside for ball number one. Kaylee Mudge, love her routine. You'll see her look at her bat, take that deep breath, a little smile comes across her face, and she steps back in.
Huge piece of this offense for Florida State. Coach Lonnie Alameda made the comment, we go as Mudge goes. She's going to be key for us this weekend.
Trying to go inside, won't get the call. John Baca is behind home plate for us today. We do have a four-person umpiring crew in the tournament, so there's an umpire at every base, and we also have video review in play. Strike two. And what we noticed last night, and I'm sure Florida State did watching Sarah Willis operate, she's slow. She takes her time in between pitches.
And as a hitter, when I'm stepping in the box, it's on my time, not yours. So if it comes down to that point as a hitter when you're in there, it's like, hey, I'm going to call time. I'm going to try to mess up your routine and get in your head. You aren't going to own the pace of play for me when I step in the box.
Strikeout to start the game for Sarah Willis.
And look at the bite on the screwball just tailing away. It almost had a little bit of downward spin. It looked like Mudge didn't have a chance at that pitch. Really deceptive movement on the outer half. And I mean, Sarah Willis, she throws it hard. That last pitch coming in at 67 miles an hour. But let's be real, it seems hotter when her changeup is on point. She can throw that pitch at 55 to 60 miles an hour. Really great spin and movement, and it adds just so much to the toolbox when she goes up and with that curveball in the velo department.
Janai Kerr, the center fielder, taking the first pitch. It rolls foul. This has been a key bat for Florida State this season, leading them hitting .396. She's had multiple hits in her last three games, including a 2-for-3 outing last night.
Yeah, to me, Kerr is such a huge piece as well to this offensive production by Florida State. She's a confident hitter. We asked Coach Lonnie Alameda about her. She's the biggest difference, honestly, was the confidence and getting that work in, really work with the volunteer assistant Kaylee Rafter every single day, putting in the work, getting the swings in, and building up that confidence in herself.
And you see that come out in her at bats. Just gets after it.
First inning is important to establish the strike zone. See Sarah Willis getting pinched a little bit on the outer half. I know I talked a lot about this yesterday, but the importance of just the battery and the catcher to continue to have a pitcher's back and say, hey, I'm going to work and get you that pitch. I'm going to get you that screwball.
She's trying to get that outside corner, but not getting the call.
Well, and that's a key pitch against those lefties. And I think when you're able to throw that screwball, you saw the swing and miss on Kaylee Mudge. It's just so important to be able to locate that pitch, get that movement away. And then that opens up her being able to come to the inner half if she can get those lefties looking at the screwball tail on the other side.
I see her numbers from last night, went the distance. Six hits, just one earned run allowed, only walked one, and struck out four. There's a change right down the middle of the plate.
And what's one thing Sarah Willis talked to us about in the interview right out of the gate? I was nervous yesterday.
Yeah.
Like, when you're getting the ball, this is her first postseason with UCF. Like, this is what it's all about. So it takes sometimes that one time through the lineup or first three hitters to figure out what the butterflies are. They stabbing? What type of feeling are you getting? But enjoying that pressure feel.
And how does that excitement, that adrenaline affect your pitches?
Well, the adrenaline piece adds where you almost try to overthrow a little bit because you're so hyped up. You feel good, and it's not that it's a bad feeling, but the heart's pumping. You're in those moments, but at times, a lot of the time, pitching coaches will say, like, hey, take your breath. Go back to what makes you great, and remember what it's like when you're in the bullpen. If you try to overthrow with these pitchers, it's just not going to work. They have to rely on the movement, the confidence of hitting those good spots. And sometimes it makes the changeup a little harder and not as good command of that pitch.
Kerr reaching out, hanging in there.
And that's back-to-back screwballs on the outer half. So if I'm Kerr right now, my mindset on this next pitch is changeup all the way. That's what's in the forefront of my brain. Going on this seventh pitch of the at-bat, knowing, hey, she's gone back-to-back pitches of heat on the outer half with the screw. She's going to try to sneak one by me, try to be on time with it. Little curveball on the hands there. It's coming, Courtney.
I believe you.
If you're wondering.
I believe you. One of us has been in this situation, and it's not me. This will be the eighth pitch to Kerr. We talked about Kerr's confidence growing, her being smarter on the field. It comes in at bats. She can make the adjustment better mid at bat.
I'm sitting change here. And I'm sitting change, but I'm saying, I think it's almost a little bit of a pitch backwards approach is what you're seeing, because one thing we know, Sarah Willis has a great change. She throws it a lot, but I think sometimes when you're thinking that, Coach Cindy Ball Malone, the head coach who also calls pitches for UCF, might be in that backwards approach mentality.
Meaning what?
Meaning, okay, they think the change is going to come here. This would be the perfect time. We're going to go hard on the hands. We're going to go with the screwball away. We're not going to give them a pitch that maybe they're sitting on. We want to throw that pitch maybe when they least expect it. And if you do throw it, try to keep it somewhat down and low in the zone. This is a big league at bat.
This will be the 10th pitch to Kerr.
This is what she just does so well. She's patient. She's not swinging at pitches way out of the zone. She's fouling off pitches that have come close. And potentially be sitting something hard in a way. Or that off speed here.
There's a change piece.
And I will be really interested as this goes on to just see what the approach is from these Florida State hitters as far as the tempo of Sarah Willis. I mean, that last in-between pitch is coming at 42 seconds, right? So the hitter has a routine that they like to do. The pitcher has that routine. But sometimes as a hitter, like I said earlier, it comes down to, hey, like, you're not going to sit here and make me wait for an additional 20 seconds. I'm going to make and kind of ice you a little bit and try to call time. So it'll be interesting to see how they approach it as this game goes on.
Twelfth pitch coming.
I think she's going to go screw here. You've seen her go with the off speed. You saw her just kind of go in on the hands at 67 miles an hour. I don't think she's going to go back to the change. I think she's going to try to get that late break on the screwball. I'm trying to push it to the defense. I'm going to say, hey, to my left side, got Jada Cody, you got Jazz Williams. I'm going to try to get you that screwball on the outer half, make a great play on this 12th pitch of the AB for me.
This is the second batter she's faced. I feel like we're in the sixth inning.
I know. It's all about.
This is incredible.
This is what feeds the offense, and this is why she's in the two spot. She's there for a reason. She's one of the most scrappiest hitters. She sees a lot of pitches going on the 13th pitch of this at bat, and that's what instills confidence in the rest of your offense. It kind of gives you that just response of like, dang, she's seen a lot of pitches, she's seen it well. It kind of gives you that mentality of like, all right, hey, I can do that. I'm not going to be fooled. It's a good AB.
Thirteenth pitch to Janai Kerr. Change back to Willis. And Sarah Willis and her defense win the chess match with Janai Kerr on a 13-pitch at bat. It took 7 minutes.
7 minutes and 13 pitches later, and you see Kerr obviously fooled, body's moving forward, still able to get a barrel on it, but not a lot of pop behind your legs, moving before your upper body. Really good job by Sarah Willis to execute that pitch and still be able to fool her on the 13th pitch.
Wow, what a battle to start this game. Kaylee Harding now been on deck for a lifetime. Had a two-run home run yesterday, her 10th home run of the season. Got her to swing at the change. Sarah Willis told us coming in to UCF, her change was in the 40s, so she brought it up into the 50s, throwing a little bit harder.
Yeah, 40, it's too slow.
Yeah.
Your weight can generate forward, and still you can move your hands back to be on time with that pitch coming in so slow. But what she's been throwing now really complements the hard stuff.
Willis ahead, 1-2. Two strikeouts in that inning for Sarah Willis.
Makes it a little bit sweeter.
Kennedy Searcy, the left fielder, to lead off. Fouls off the first pitch. UCF, 40 wins for the third straight season. That is the first time in program history that has happened. And we were talking to Cindy Ball Malone before regional start. She told us, look, we don't have to prove anymore that we deserve to be in this tournament. We are building a history here with UCF, and now that pressure's off. We're going to go out and play our best.
And think about how much pressure you feel when you feel like you always need to prove yourself. Now that you've eliminated that mindset because you know you belong, you just get to go play. And that's when you know you're having fun. And we talked to Lonnie Alameda prior to this game, and we talked about the feel of what it's like going into a day like today. And she said, you know, when we look back at last year, like, we went in with the mentality of not wanting to lose and the pressure of what it's like of being expected to win. And she said, this year it's been a completely different mindset. This group looks so different. It's cool to see.
That's something they've talked about all season for Florida State, what happened last year. Last year for UCF, I mean, they made history. Their first super regional appearance, they got to host a regional. They were the 16th seed. Cindy Ball Malone took her program. They went to Oklahoma for super regionals, which is tough for anyone. Facing the eventual national champions again. K-time, the crowd wanted it. Kat Sandercock delivered.
And what makes Kat Sandercock so good is she's primarily down in the zone, but she loves to spin this rise ball. And when you're getting swings and misses like that on Cersei, it just adds fuel to the fire where it's like, all right, I can still spot the down. I know you're susceptible to the up. It just gives you more confidence when you're out there.
Jada Cody, the third baseman. Foul ball. Want to mention, too, looking at UCF's lineup, you won't see Michaela Macario in the lineup today. We saw her take a hard hit yesterday, two hard hits yesterday. One on defense, one when she was base running. She did not warm up today, so that shifted a few things around. Aubrey Evans will be at second today. Olivia Elliott will be in the DP.
And most, when you think of UCF and you think of that run that they made last year, the name Jada Cody pops up, right? You look at the numbers, I mean, 15 home runs last year, 75 RBIs. She was such a big piece to just giving them that first ever regional host. And even though the numbers are down, she's a player that thrives in the postseason. She has good at-bats, and she's a player that I don't want to beat me. And you look at her last seven games, 391, has those six RBIs. She's still swinging it.
This one hops over to Kaylee Harding. Two down.
When I got a chance to talk with Coach Alameda a little bit briefly before the game, it was just a quick run in, and I was just talking to her about like the pressure feels and what it feels like going into a game like today. And something that I recognize about both these two coaches is just the like that true trust of the athlete to just go out and do what they've done and practiced all year long. And sometimes you'll see when you get to these moments, like you go as the head coach goes, right? So if you feel that tension or you feel that pressure, sometimes you will see that out there on the field. But Coach Lonnie Alameda feels so solid with this group and say, hey, we're hanging our hat. I'm putting in the work. We've done it. I just have to trust it. And that's all that I can do. Coaches can't control what happens once the athlete crosses the lines.
Strike two, Aubrey Evans.
Aubrey Evans, feisty yesterday, had some really good at-bats off Donnie Goborn. She was on time with the hard. She did a really good job of hitting those pitches missed.
A 2-for-2 yesterday with two walks and a double. She's now on a five-game hit streak. This is just a freshman, too. trying to dig out of a 0-2 hole, now up to 1-2 against Kat Sandercock.
And this is when, as a hitter, you start to think, all right, hey, she got Searcy on that pitch up in the zone when she was ahead. She's going to climb that ladder. Can I get on top of it? And then she snipes you with the drop.
Strikeout number two, Catherine Sandercock, a very efficient inning for the fifth-year player. Coming up next for Florida. So impressive. Mack Leonard leading off the second. First pitch, it's going to be in foul territory. Can they get the grab? Jasmine Williams, challenge accepted.
She's making it look easy. Mack Leonard, this screwball on the outer half, just runs it down. Jada Cody going for it too, but notices her teammates got a little bit better of a jump. This is an athlete that Coach Cindy Ball Malone, as soon as she, Jazz Williams, entered that transfer portal from Oregon, it was like, boom, we got to get her. She had that experience coaching that U19 Team USA with Williams.
And knew what she was capable of. Florida State swinging early. Devin Flaherty out to Kennedy Searcy and left.
You're definitely seeing a little bit of an adjustment made here by Florida State in the sense where they're swinging a little bit earlier in the count, knowing Sarah Willis wants to get you early so then she can toy with you and spread that zone a little bit, but two quick outs here.
Callie Waycaster now. She lays off that first pitch. It comes in for a ball. Waycaster 1-for-3 against Marist on Friday. Had a run scored and an RBI. She's got 3 hits over her last 7 games. Over Williams, making the throw at short and a very quick inning. A four.
Just the commitment to pitching by committee and owning your role and her being able to come in and kind of strip the ego piece. She's so good at that. And that's why I'm always such a fan of Florida State with how they do it in the circle.
Chloe Evans got the grass in left. Two bags for Chloe Evans on the first pitch to lead off the second. And look at her go. They have a celebration for every base they stop on. It's different.
Well, Chloe Evans has been swinging one of the hottest bats here for UCF. And this is a drop ball that misses. If it's supposed to be in, you got to throw it in. And just misses over the heart of the plate. She takes it to left center, and it finds a gap between the two speedy outfielders, Kerr and Mudge, and she is fired up.
Look, Aubrey Evans has the single season record right now for doubles, and now Chloe Evans is one away from tying her. That was her 16th double of the season.
Did you say Morgan and Morgan? Or
yep.
Evans and Evans.
Lyle and Lori. Shannon Doherty. Popping up just on the edge of center, in crashes Janai Kerr, one away. Interesting, we're seeing both teams get more aggressive on that first pitch in these ABs coming up.
Well, it's because there is a ton of respect for these pitchers and how well they do when they get ahead. So if I can get ahead of you, and then for someone like a Catherine Sandercock, now I know you're swinging early in the count. She can toy around a little bit, but you want to get ahead of the wicked movement. Knowing and respecting a pitcher like that is going to bring you something early. That's why you've been seeing both these teams swinging a little bit earlier, passing on that information to the rest of their team.
It's Jasmine Williams. She'll take a cut at that first pitch, too.
I mean, we got to sit down and talk with Kat Sandercock in the circle. She's someone that we requested. I just wanted to talk about, I mean, this is the last time you're going to see Kat in the postseason. It's almost like kind of the sad part about our job is you get to know these players through watching them and calling their games, and then you kind of close that chapter.
straight to Bethany Keene, looking for two. Won't get Evans. She gets back to second safely.
This is just straight fuego. I love it. Keene knows right away. To the little athletes that are watching, the importance of understanding, ball comes to me on the ground, what do I do? Ball comes to me in the air, what do I do? And it was instantly, next play, is Evans off the bag enough where I can double her up? That's a money play on that.
Olivia Elliott, the DP, her sixth start of the season. We mentioned no Michaela Macario in the lineup for UCF today, and she was banged up a couple of times yesterday. Did not warm up with the team. And so in comes Olivia Elliott, the freshman. 250 on the season.
There's
Macario in the dugout. She played her heart out yesterday.
She did, yeah. She just got hit a couple times, sliding into second, swiped on the tag, and then covering that bunt at first. Glad she's all good. Good lights. If I'm Elliott, I'm going to be patient here, but also understand that this is a good pitch, potentially, that may be coming my way at a 3-1 count.
Got a piece. Full count now, two outs after Chloe Evans led off the inning with a double.
I love it. You see Catherine Sandercock take that big, deep breath. The importance for those pitchers to have that routine, what they rely on, especially when they need to execute a big pitch in a moment.
Hopped it, over goes Chloe Evans to third. And Olivia Elliott will take that. Runners on the corners now. Pitcher versus pitcher, Sarah Willis walking up.
And we saw Sarah Willis yesterday. I mean, it almost looked like it unintentionally, intentionally pitching around her, Donnie Goborn. I mean, she didn't get a single pitch even close to the zone her first three ABs.
She walked three times.
Back-to-back-to-back walks. And we even asked her, are you a little surprised? She goes, no, not really.
I mean, she'll take it.
I mean, she's swaggy. I like that answer. Yeah, I'm not surprised.
Off the end of the bat, taking that first pitch.
But something I feel like you don't get to see enough of anymore in our game are those two-way players. And I don't know if pitchers are being told when they're younger that, hey, you got to stick towards just one, the offense or the defense. And I think that that is just false information. I think if you're a good enough athlete and you can be great at both, do it. There's no greater value than being able to step in the box with a runner on third and potentially try to help yourself out when you're in the circle.
Sandercock ahead, 0-2. Olivia Elliott started going and then paused. Now she's at second.
When it's the bait game, it's trying to bait Mikayla Edenfield to do something, to make that throw, to get into the pickle with Chloe Evans, who's at third base. And I think in this type of a moment, it's just respecting the count, trusting who you have out there. We have a 1-2 count against Sarah Willis. You have your ace in the circle. Let her go out and try to execute this moment without letting anything get out of control.
Not going anywhere yet. Runners were moving quickly. Sandercock. UCF leads 2 in scoring position. .789 leading off. Mikayla Edenfield will swing at the first pitch from Sarah Willis. A 4-pitch inning from Willis last time around. And Florida State, they went back their first team meeting of the fall. They watched the regional finals where they lost to Mississippi State. They talked about it. What did they see? And Kat Sandercock told us the energy, it just wasn't there. It wasn't right.
I mean, that was definitely one of... It's emotional when you go back and you do watch and you see those players like Sid Sherrill and just Josie Muffley just bawling her eyes out. Because we do know this sport is getting so much better. The parity is like nothing else. So on any given day, you can get beat. But when you get beat twice in one day, something is lacking. And they took note of that. And I don't think you can ever, doesn't matter who you are, Courtney, it doesn't matter if you're Oklahoma, if you're UCLA, or you're Florida State, you cannot go into a game cocky expecting to win. It has to be a pure respect of this game and going out with the mentality that this team is trying to take what you want and you've worked and you've put in that time. And I mean,
being the 2 seed and being eliminated.
And you look at UCLA potentially on the brink of that as the 2 seed.
They've got a tough road now for losing yesterday.
They'll have to square off against Liberty today.
Got to win 2 today and 2 tomorrow. Edenfield, hopper over to Jada Cody. It's a long throw. It's in time. Bethany Keene originally started her college ball at USF. Had a walk yesterday, had the championship winning hit though in the ACC tournament final. Her first hit since April 30th.
Well, and just going back to dig even a little deeper in the numbers, you look at her last 9 games, 3-for-12, and only has those 2 RBIs, which ended up coming big in that conference game. But it comes down to sometimes just one good, really good swing on a pitch that just ignites this sense of confidence in yourself and completely turns it around. Because at times there's nothing worse when you're stepping in the box, putting on that added pressure of, I need to, I need to, I need to. Instead, it's just about going back to the routine, trying to get a good swing on a pitch you can do something with. We talked with Coach Cindy Ball-Malone just about Sarah Willis and kind of developing a little bit more into that, I guess you would say, ace. Someone that they're going to put out there in back-to-back starts, but it's taken a little bit of time to kind of get her comfortable out there and really kind of putting herself in a spot where she's feeling good. I mean, the pitcher has only allowed 2 home runs in these last 23, but prior, I mean, 21 home runs in the first 36 games of the season. So she was testing some things out early. She's really found a good thing going here with Sarah Willis midway through the season.
And keep in mind, too, Sarah Willis, I mean, last year at Washington, she only made 4 appearances. So she wasn't used to this workload and being the ace. And once they kind of figured out where she fit best, she's really settled in nicely and owned this role.
And I think that really comes down to that relationship with Cindy Ball-Malone and how much she's individually able to get in tune with the athlete, especially the pitcher, because you know you don't have pitching, you're not going to win. So it comes down to being able to break down these pitchers, but also let them know that you're their biggest fan, you're going to help get them through it. When you know the coach is in your back pocket, you feel invincible.
Bethany Keene, no! Chloe Evans got there! She is everywhere.
I mean, Chloe Evans is the energy that I wish I could have every single day. Laying it all out. We saw her make a killer play yesterday in right field. And Sarah Willis just absolutely loving it. You're seeing a ton of smiles from UCF.
10 out of 10 on the fist pump. And that brings us to the number 9 hitter, Josie Muffley, who's got a special cheering section in center field. Josie Muffley, after softball's done, she's hoping to be a firefighter. So she volunteers with the Tallahassee Fire Department with a couple of different stations, does ride-alongs with them. It's something she started in high school. We even have a camera on the fire truck. Let's go.
I love it.
How about that seat, though, right in center field?
Not too shabby.
How cool they come out and support her.
I know. Hey, a dead shot to center wouldn't be too shabby.
I know Florida State wouldn't mind.
With them out there.
Oh, didn't get that changeup called. Oh, Brett, our graphics producer. She's catching fire. Stop.
Love to see it.
Last 5 games, a couple of home runs. First 54 games, none. See what you did there? I'll take it. I don't hate it.
I'm here for it. Hashtag catching fire.
Could be confused with the Hunger Games.
Umpire calling time on Sarah Willis. I think an issue or a warning, excuse me, was being issued potentially on the time. I mean, we do know that she takes a lot of time in between pitches. You see the volunteer assistant coach, Kaylee Rafter, and now Lonnie Alameda is making her way to John Baca behind the plate.
Yeah, he didn't give her a ball because it's still 3 balls, no strikes.
I like this. I like this. I think that there has to be something said for the hitter to not have to wait as long as they have had to wait. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying this is all Sarah Willis. I think it's, you know, you're getting the calls from the dugout, and sometimes it is just that extra time, but the pace of play is important too. So for him to go out and try to, you know, speed that up a little bit, I don't mind it.
Three-0 count to Muffley. And then Sarah Willis comes back with the change for a strike.
Dirty. And that's the confidence you have to have in that pitch. So if pitchers are watching, what makes elite level pitchers elite is the confidence to throw pitches regardless of the count and being able to spot it where they want. I mean, 3-0, you're throwing the change. Muffley not expecting that. I go back to back.
Pops up in the infield. Jasmine Williams calling everyone off. And 1-2-3. Sent down. Three strikeouts on the afternoon for Catherine Sandercock. She's given up one hit. It was a double and walked one. And now the number nine hitter is up. It'll be 9-1-2 facing Sandercock here in the third. Janisha Rowe. Going bunt. Sandercock is the first to get there, and Rowe beats it out. We saw this in the second inning. More aggressive at bat, swinging earlier in the count.
I mean, plus when your nine hitter can just drop that bunt, turn the lineup over as quick as she just did right there. I mean, and you couldn't have painted a prettier picture of where you wanted that ball to go with the infielders back a little bit. I mean, that was picture perfect.
Top of the order for the second time. Kennedy Searcy struck out first time up against Catherine Sandercock. She was showing bunt two. It's foul. Kennedy Searcy, she moved into this leadoff position, the top of the order, March 29th against North Florida, and UCF has gone 23-1 since she's let off.
Just kind of looking at Kat Sandercock's numbers. I mean, facing 10 hitters, she's thrown 9 first pitch strikes. She's been efficient. She's gotten ahead. You like that she gives up the leadoff bunt and then just goes straight to town on Searcy with back-to-back strikes fouling off that bunt. I mean, miss a game.
Oh, yeah. I mean, we talked about the importance of this, too.
I mean, not that I didn't think it was going to be, but I just think when you're in it and you have two really dominant pitchers and just offenses that are going at it, so much energy, so much on the line, packed house, it just says the postseason all wrapped up with a little bow on it.
Remember, winner of this game moves right to the regional final tomorrow. The loser will play again later today, approximately 6 Eastern. Marist in South Carolina will play an elimination game 35 minutes after the conclusion of this game.
It's a marathon. Saturday is a marathon across the
Not
board.
A sprint.
No.
Marathon.
I have to keep reminding myself of that. I'm wondering if we'll see Kat Sandercock climb the ladder a little bit. You kind of go back to Searcy in her last at-bat where she struck out. What was the pitch she came on? It was that rise ball up in the zone. So for Kat Sandercock, obviously pitches are being called from the dugout with Coach Lonnie Alameda, but especially at an 0-2 count, wouldn't mind something up in the zone trying to see if you can get that big chase.
Searcy, slow roller back to Sandercock. She retires Searcy, but Janisha Rowe is able to move into scoring position. Good opportunity for Jada Cody now. Runner in scoring position. Last six games, she's hitting 391 with a home run and six RBI. One of those RBI came last night. UCF 0 for 3 today with runners in scoring position. Jada Cody, an All-American last season, the single-season record for RBI at UCF.
It's back-to-back off-speed pitches there by Sandercock. This is where you need to be careful. You have that runner on second base. Tie ball game with a hitter that numbers may not be jumping off the page, but to me, she's a player that rises to the occasion, no doubt. I mean, she's someone I don't want to let beat me.
To left field. Foul. UCF was running out of the dugout.
You know what I'm going to say.
Long strike.
Long strike.
Pitcher.
Long strike.
You know Jada Cody loves this situation, though. Runner in scoring position. She's second in career RBI in UCF history. Yep.
Coach Cindy Ball Malone switched up positions. She used to be coaching third base and kind of put herself in a position to stay in the dugout. Has really liked being able to kind of connect with the athletes prior to them getting in the on-deck circle and stepping in the box.
Yeah, they switched up all roles on their coaching staff. Jen Salling at first, Tyler Heil at third. They switched offensive and defensive responsibilities, and she's like, I don't think the team noticed, but, you know, like a month in, I said it in a team meeting. I was like, guys, did you realize we switched responsibilities? She said, whatever the team needs, that's what we're going to do, even the coaches. Jada Cody takes that walk, second walk today by Catherine Sandercock. Lonnie Alameda out to the circle. Aubrey Evans coming up next. Well, the Women's College World Series returns to Oklahoma City. Action beginning Thursday, June 1st at noon Eastern, live on ESPN. For more information on the 2023 Women's College World Series, go to NCAA.com, the official online home for all 90 NCAA championships.
And I like Coach Lonnie Alameda calling time there. Going out, just kind of rallying the troops, having a quick conversation about the plan of attack. She's always just so calm, and that's something that you appreciate out of a head coach, just calm demeanor.
And right after that, Catherine Sandercock delivering the strike.
Yep, little drop on the outer half.
First pitch strike to Aubrey Evans.
Sandercock has really had to take on a whole bunch of different roles this season. When you think about it, Courtney, I mean, last year she was a starter constantly, and had a conversation with Lonnie Alameda prior to this season kicking off, and it was just, hey, we're going to need you to potentially come into games and already have the pressure supplied, the bases loaded. She didn't love it right out of the gate, but she truly has now been in a spot where she's known every single role, has been able to help other pitchers, loves those pressure-filled moments.
And Lonnie Alameda got emotional talking about the sacrifices that Kat Sandercock has made for this team. She told us, if Kat doesn't buy in to what I asked her to do, we're not in this situation.
Well, it's because you think nowadays there's a lot of these athletes that want the accolades. They want the All-American. They want to be the players of the year. And don't get me wrong, those are great things. But at the end of the day, it's team first. How can I help the team? What can I do for the team? And it just goes to show how selfless she is. And you just even look over the course of the last couple of years with Sandercock, 2021, 178 innings pitched on the year. Last season, 194. 2023, 151. So innings down, but learning more about herself than I even think she thought possible with just enduring the different roles. It's different coming into games late in the game.
Yeah.
It's different coming into games, bases loaded with two out, and having to get the team out of the jam and owning the emotions of those moments.
She told us, I'll give up the individual accolades if for a deep postseason run.
Yeah.
She was the conference pitcher of the year, though.
She was. Yes.
1-2. Back at Sandercock. Two down, two in scoring position now.
This is a scrappy AB here, Courtney, with just how Chloe Evans has been swinging it. A ton of energy.
Made that huge catch in right field. Momentum behind her. Mm. First pitch swinging. Chloe Evans, two seasons at Minnesota. She was an All-Big Ten second team selection. Everyday starter in the outfield for them. Led them with 46 RBI, and she's come to UCF, where it's a bit warmer than Minnesota, and still leading them in RBI and hits.
And she's someone, in my opinion, that she has a unique stance. Like, you take a look at where she's at in the box, she's standing tall all the way, feet very close together. And from this tall stance, then she's going to create that momentum with her lower half and try to be on time with the pitch. But if I'm the pitcher and I know that someone has a lot more movement than maybe the average hitter, that's when I have to remember how much my stuff moves, use that to my advantage. Potentially climb the ladder.
Josie Muffley trying to dive, one run across. Cody trying to get back to third, and Chloe Evans. Energy, overload, UCF up 1-0.
And the plan of attack against Chloe Evans here, I mean, this is one of the hottest hitters with UCF. She's going for the yard swing there. Back-to-back big swings and misses. But this is a pitch on the outer half at an 0-2 count. I need better. I need better with the pressure of what's going on in this situation, knowing this is a hitter that's not going to strike out. She's scrappy. I got to move it off the plate a little bit.
There's Shannon Doherty. Chloe Evans. A triple, a double, a single, four RBI, and her last three at-bats in this regional. It all started with this inning, though, with Jonisha Rowe laying down that bunt on the first pitch to get on. The 0-2 to Doherty. Strikeout number four for Catherine Sandercock. Florida State 1-0, and we're joined now by Florida State head coach Lonnie Alameda. And coach, we were just talking about Kat Sandercock and her buy-in to this pitching staff concept. How important was her buy-in to getting you guys to this point this season?
I mean, hugely important. You know, I think it's kind of where the game's going in general, and but you also want to have the most rested, you know, staff at this point too in the season. So, but she's been tremendous. She's grown every year. You know, she's got great mentorship from big moments. Danielle knows this, right? Big moments, take a breath, execute a pitch. You know, I think her experience has really showed up. So, yeah.
Coach, third time through the lineup here. What's the message to the hitters? Is it try to be on time with the change, hunt the change? What is it?
Well, I think it depends on hitter specific. Some like the change, some like the hard, you know. Some got short games, some can be able to go for a big swing. So it becomes hitter specific at that point, you know, do what you do. So I would see some adjustments here at the top of the lineup. I think Mudge and JJ are pretty good ones at that. So expect that a little bit different.
Yeah, awesome. Thanks, Coach. We appreciate your time.
Thank you all.
So we saw the adjustments for Florida State yesterday against Marist. First time through the lineup, one hit. After that, nine hits, nine runs.
And I think that you kind of sparked this within a team of like, okay, let's talk shop. Let's figure it out. How are we going to adjust? So, I mean, she said it look for Mudge and Kerr to make those big time adjustments. And the top of the order sets the tone, right? Like, I mean, Coach Lonnie Alameda made it known, like, we're going to go as Kaylee Mudge goes. She's someone that is a big spark plug for us in that offense. She can be hard on herself. She can put a decent amount of pressure. But when it comes down to it, she's who we want up there to lead the charge.
I remember her telling us Mudge just does Mudge things. Yep. Just gets after it, works. One, one. If you're just joining us, last inning we saw the home plate umpire, John Baca, come out and talk to Sarah Willis about the time in between pitches. Our stats crew, led by Jeff Muir, is tracking that. She's averaging 30.8 seconds between her pitches.
Do you know the time of what a pitcher clock would be? 20. So she'd have some time she'd have to make up for there. But I also put a little bit on the hitter as well. Like if a pitcher's taking a long time, call time.
Right.
And we haven't really seen that. The only kind of debacle that we've seen was when Josie Muffley was in there and the umpire kind of took charge. But if you find that you're standing in the box and you're just waiting and waiting and waiting, that's when you can overthink it.
That one well outside. Sarah Willis has thrown very well today, came out confident. She told us yesterday a little bit of nerves in game one, but has not allowed a hit today. Struck out two.
The postseason is a new season, and it's a different flood of emotions, especially being a starting pitcher. It's kind of the best part about the game, but.
Change up right back at Willis. And Mudge is safe. Runner on for the first time today for Florida State. First hit of the day.
Kaylee Mudge breaks up the no-hitter. She sits back on the chain. She got a good piece of this. Sarah Willis gloves it up, but a lot of speed up the line. Ooh, and she just gets her foot in there. You got to remember, Kerr's last AB, 13 pitches over 7 minutes in that at-bat in the first inning. Scrappy in that two spot, and an opportunity here to try to advance that runner 60 feet and put Harding and Leonard in that RBI situation.
Tying run at first right now. Yeah, it was an incredible battle at the beginning of this game. Janai Kerr, you mentioned, 13 pitch at bat. Eventually hit it right back to Sarah Willis, who sent it over to Doherty at first. But 7 minutes of drama.
7 minutes.
There goes Mudge. And the throw pulls Aubrey Evans over off the bag. Mudge, no problem getting in. 15th stolen base of the season. Florida State aggressive on the base pass. There's 8 teams in the field that have over 100 stolen bases, and 3 of them are in Tallahassee. Pop up. No chance for a play. Into the netting.
Gotta love the response here from Florida State. UCF scoring in the bottom of the third. Florida State trying to answer back this second time through with the leadoff. Kaylee Mudge getting the first hit of the game.
Kerr pops up towards center. Janisha Rowe is there. Mudge trying to go to third. Nope, going back to second. Now Kaylee Harding up with one out and a runner in scoring position. Junior out of Murfreesboro, Tennessee, had a big swing for the Noles yesterday. Struck out her first time up today. And Kaylee Harding for the 10th time this year, she went yard, a 2-run shot.
Yeah, she took this. I think this was the furthest ball out of all of them that was hit. Went out and hit the sidewalk, pavement out there.
One of 3 home runs yesterday for Florida State in their 9-0 5-inning win against Marist.
Good spot by Sarah Willis, spot in the outside corner with that curveball. Someone that definitely thrives in these pressure-filled moments. To mention, obviously having a great changeup with Willis, but as a hitter, it's trying to be on time with the windup because she's super slow and takes a long time, and then she gets the sign and she goes back into her back leg and takes a second. So as a hitter, it's okay, how am I going to kind of be on time? So when I step in the box right now, she's getting on the mound, but she's looking towards the dugout. So what am I looking at as a hitter? What am I trying to track? And when am I going to start my load? Is it when she kind of goes into that back leg?
Is that something you're watching too while you're waiting to bat, like in the dugout? You're watching her pattern?
And it's picking where you'd feel the most ready. And when she loads and she gets into her back leg, I wouldn't load there. I load here. So as soon as she gets her momentum going into her front right leg, that's when I'm going to start the lower momentum on my legs and my arms and what I want to do to get ready. But she's just got so much action. But that always comes back to what? The routine. It's what pitchers do. It's what makes her successful.
Rolled up the middle past Willis. Jasmine Williams hustling for it. Both runners safe, runners on the corners.
And Florida State answering back here in the top of the fourth inning, being scrappy, trying to get some stuff going. Not big swings to the outfield, but enough pop on it to get a couple base hits.
Their first two hits of the game. And now the tying run at third, the go-ahead run at first for Mack Leonard. Leonard had an RBI double yesterday. She also got the start in the circle, picked up her first win of the season. Only saw one pitch in her first at bat in the second inning. Go and change the first time.
And there are definitely hitters that'll step in the box, Courtney, that want to sit change. And then you'll have other hitters where it's like, ooh, until it's last minute and I'm 0-2, I don't want to swing at it if I don't have to. So as far as the adjustment piece on a pitcher that executes the change well, it comes down to how comfortable you are in the moment and what you prefer to sit on.
Mack Leonard going towards second. Aubrey Evans taking care of it, but Mudge coming home, and we got a tie game.
Really good job by Mack Leonard, especially with hitting that ball right side of the infield, which gives the speedy Mudge that chance to cross home. I mean, you hit it to the left side of the infield, they are going to take a peek at her all day, and that run will not score. Good timely hitting there.
So a quick huddle in the infield here for UCF. Sarah Willis carried a no-hitter into this inning. And Kaylee Mudge, the first batter she faced, got the single. Kaylee Harding followed that up with a single of her own. And then Mack Leonard bringing home Mudge. Get you to Devin Flaherty.
Not too shabby. To me, it's the no walks. She's been efficient. She does a good job of putting pressure on these hitters, making them swing at pitches out of the zone a little bit.
Now can Flaherty help out Harding at second?
Good situation here for Devin Flaherty. That 2-0 count, expect something, whether or not she goes with the changeup at the 2-0 count. Flaherty has been so good in that five spot for Florida State. Big leader of this team. Good opportunity here.
Ball coming in inside to Flaherty. And that's ball four. First walk issued by Sarah Willis, and Cindy Ball Malone out to the circle.
4 years to experience these types of moments, it should be a little bit nerve-wracking at first. And then it's understanding, all right, hey, what did those feel like? So for her, going into a game like today where there's going to be a lot more pressure, I mean, this crowd, we all know that Florida State's only lost two games all year at home. They play well at home. You know that. You're aware of that. But it's learning to go through kind of the emotions of what those pressure moments feel like and saying, hey, like, all I got to do is execute a pitch. If I can go back to what makes me great and not let all the outside noise get in between the ears, I'm in a good spot.
And she came out so strong today. Two strikeouts in the first inning. Callie Waycaser, high hopper to Jada Cody. And Florida State is going to leave two on, but not before they tie ball game. We also have UCF head coach Cindy Ball Malone joining us now. And coach, we saw you go out and talk to Sarah Willis in the circle. Then she was able to get out of that inning with her defense. What did you tell her?
Oh, I just thought she was overthrown a little bit, and she's too good to do that. You know, she can mix speed. She can throw up, down, in, out. So way too good for anyone to kind of get her to get out of a routine.
Coach, talk to me a little bit about the offense, but more importantly to me, Chloe Evans has been such a fun spark plug for you guys. I know she's right behind you, so if you want to talk about her, she's there, but she's been fun to watch over the last couple days.
Yeah, I mean, Chloe's just, like I said before, she's a competitor. I would love when she's up. She can hit any pitch, uses all the field, and she's got speed, so she's a tough out. But just our lineup in general, I love how they're sticking to a plan. I'd like to see us be more aggressive in our last at bat with runners at second and third, but I think we're doing a really good job of, you know, against a dominant pitcher. So,
yeah, heck of a game, Coach. Thanks for your time.
Thank you. Good night.
This is what you want, right? I mean, this feels like postseason. I love it.
Yep.
Our first game of three today, and you heard Coach Cindy Ball Malone talk about that meeting. She's got so much confidence in Sarah Willis just to go out there, knows what she wants now, because that's what the whole season's about, building that relationship, figuring each other out, pitch caller to the pitcher.
Yep. And just being comfortable being uncomfortable, meaning situations are going to arise where, hey, you're maybe getting exploited, but not in a bad way. It's just learning that this can be such an emotional roller coaster once you hit postseason, because we know that only one team's coming out of this weekend. We're saying goodbye to three, and then there will be 16 left, and that's it, out of 64. So when you look at it that way and you're like, dang, within a day and a half we're coming out with just one, if you're thinking that way as an athlete, oh boy, that's pressure right out of the gate that I'm feeling. But if you're just in the right mindset of like, okay, all I can control is executing my job as a pitcher, being able to make that adjustment as a hitter, thinking the game when I'm out there on defense, ball comes to me, where am I going? Just being present.
Jasmine Williams facing Catherine Sandercock. It's 6, 7, and 8 in the lineup. That stays fair, fired at Kaylee Harding, and she fires over to Bethany King. Game one of our triple header today. Don't forget, coming up after this game, we'll have an elimination game. Our first, speaking of elim, our first elimination game in Tallahassee, South Carolina and Marist. It'll be approximately 3:30 or 35 minutes after the conclusion of this game. Loser of this game will play later tonight at 6 p.m. Opponent TBD. Aggressive from Olivia Elliott, first pitch. Look at her coming in, being asked to jump in this lineup. Just her sixth start of the season, and she has gotten on twice.
And a really good patient first at bat with the walk. And then just keeps it simple. Doesn't try to do too much. This is a drop ball up in the zone, in on the hands, and she's able to turn on this pitch and just take it right back up the middle.
First hit since April 5th against FGCU for Olivia Elliott, the freshman. Now, what can Sarah Willis do? Second time pitcher versus pitcher. To Devin Flaherty, looking for two. They will get Olivia Elliott, but they will not get Sarah Willis.
And the Noles have 27 double plays on the year, trying to make it 28. Flaherty with the toss to Muffley, but just not able to scoop it.
Willis reaching on the fielder's choice. Back to the number nine hitter, Janisha Rowe, who sparked that third inning with the bunt on the first pitch. Eventually, Chloe Evans would bring across the only run so far for UCF. It was fun last night. You know, it's a small softball world. Janisha Rowe getting to face off against her former travel ball teammate, Donnie Goborn, the pitcher for South Carolina.
Yep.
We know one of her coaches was watching. We saw them reach out on Twitter.
Yeah. You know, you love it when you just kind of get to see that come to play, especially in the regionals or the supers.
Now at the transfer portal, you have old teammates in college facing off against each other, too. Love a good backstory, right? Yeah. Like, come on.
Yes.
Sandercock ahead, 0-2 on Rowe. Kayla Edenfield, you see her behind the dish. She got the special makeup on today. It's her grandmother Mary's 78th birthday.
Yeah.
So that's in honor of her. 0-2 again. There's a little 78 drawn on her forehead, too.
She always has such good flair.
Like, I love it.
I'm here for it. She takes the time. She does it. She loves it. It's her thing, and I absolutely dig it. And I hope that she always continues to keep doing that. It's such a fun piece of the game that she brings. She drew it herself, too.
I know.
Someone reached out and sent her those colors. That's what she told us.
Love it. Happy birthday, Grandma Mary.
Rowe, scrappy AB here, battling off these 0-2 pitches.
This will be the sixth pitch to Rowe. In her second season with UCF, her first two seasons with FGCU. Checking Willis at first. She's good to go.
That was wicked close.
Oh, yeah, it was.
Sarah Willis is like, bro, they almost got me. They really did. That was.
But almost is the key part.
You're
of
right.
That.
You're right. Enfield the snap throw, throws on the money right to the bag.
That's a tough one. It gets past Harding. Muffley was trying to back her up, and it popped up. And Rowe is aboard for the second time. That's a hit.
This ball kind of just gets passed and just trickles up and gets Muffley. I don't know if it was the top of the visor and got a little dirt in the eye, but she's just taking a second. Josie Muffley's always good. Coach Lenny Alameda said, hey, the knee brace may be bigger, but she's always
play.
Good. She will always play.
There's a fire truck in center field for her. She can't not play.
Yes.
So again, Rowe is able to flip this lineup third time through the order. Kennedy Searcy, two on. Sarah Willis at second, Rowe at first, and here comes Cindy Ball Malone to John Baca behind the plate. I think they might run for, yeah, they're going to run for Sarah Willis. So Lewis coming out to pinch run. Sandercock getting the big cut coming from Searcy.
Well, and the biggest cuts of the day have been from Searcy on the pitches up in the zone. And those are things you remember as a pitcher, whether the pitches are called from the dugout or not. You feel it in your gut and you know, hey, she's been more susceptible to that pitch that's up. Why not keep spinning it there? You always love the crowd noise.
Like, I know.
Aww. Man.
All together now. Do you hear that as a pitcher? Like when you're out there, do you hear the crowd?
When they're angry, yes. When you're cruising, it's like, no. But when the little things, how you give up a home run, it's like,
What about with the K-time chant? You think Sandercock hears it?
No. I think she's so used to that because they do it so much. I like it. I like that spot, though. It's just good. It's a show-me pitch. Now that opens up another part of the plate. Try to snipe her down and in with that drop ball, or you can go away, challenge her to the left side. Everything is a setup pitch to put you in a position to execute that next pitch.
Make it 5Ks now.
And I absolutely love it because there's not one way to do it. I think Michaela Enfield called time there. This team and RBIs, that's back-to-back 50 ribby seasons for Michaela Edenfield.
She ended an 0-for-8 streak yesterday. Had that two-run home run.
Still, both pitchers to me pretty good pitch counts with kind of where they're at. And that still goes to show. I mean, last night, Sarah Willis threw only 100 pitches. You look at Donnie Goborn, her competitor, 144 pitches on the evening. So it just goes to show how efficient she's been able to be with hitting good spots, spreading that zone, throwing that changeup. These hitters are getting themselves out. And are you hacking 3-1? And if you are you in the mindset of potentially respecting that a changeup may come?
There it is. Strike two.
And that's the thing. You want to pull the trigger on the hitter's counts. But if you aren't prepared for the changeup or you're not sitting that, you can't pull the trigger because you'll get fooled. But when you get to a 3-2 count, I mean, no doubt, you have to be ready to try to get on time with a pitch like that. Just based on the movement of Michaela Edenfield with her body, I'm not opposed to throwing that pitch again.
Edenfield's calling for time. They're going to give her a ball. Taking too long. And Cindy Ball Malone just threw her papers on the floor, and she's going to call her battery out.
And Edenfield, I mean, everyone's sneaking a peek into the dugout. Edenfield, she's there. She's ready. They're still looking to the dugout. And I like this timeout here. You're waiting too long. This is my AB. I have to be able to take ownership in that moment, and she does, and it works to her favor. And I think it comes down to getting the pitches sooner.
Yeah.
Get Sarah Willis the pitches out, right? Like, they're being called from the dugout, and she's out there. She's on the mound. She's ready. So I think if Coach Cindy Ball Malone can just get them to her a little bit sooner, I don't think she'd be taking as much time.
So now you got to regroup if you're UCF, and you've got Katie Dack, who walked it off yesterday on her birthday for Florida State, up at the plate pinch hitting. Ross is pinch running at first base for Edenfield. Dak's home run yesterday, just her fourth hit in her last 11 games, but it was a big one, ended it in the fifth inning. There goes Ross. She's safe. Look at this birthday blast.
Two-run shot. Ended up walking off. Maris has to feel good on your birthday. Not sure there could be a better present. Strolling into home with your team swarming you. Crowd singing you happy birthday.
All around pretty solid day.
Pretty good day. I mean, I hope she got some cake, but I know that that's something I look forward to on my birthday.
It's ice cream cake for me.
No, I
it's my favorite.
I mean, I'm more of like nothing bun cake, but Dairy Queen ice cream cake with the fudge. Oh man, get out of here. I got a dessert in the fridge that I've been just thinking about since the first pitch of this game.
She mentions it every break.
I do. Foodie.
Ball and two strikes to Katie Dack.
Good swing on that pitch. Also a very good pitch by Sarah Willis. not a bad average for Katie Dack. 4.15 on the year with runners in scoring position.
She's got that now after the stolen base by Ross.
I like it, though. That down and away pitch at a 1-2 count is good. You've seen Dak swing back-to-back pitches. Now going with that curve on the lower half opens up potentially that screwball in on Dak's hands. If you get something in enough, put a little upspit on it. Every pitch is a setup pitch for the next one if you can execute it the way you need to.
Pretty.
It's the body by Sarah Willis. So the setup pitch for me is this pitch on the lower half. Okay, you get Katie Dack moving, and then it's just the body. I mean, look at the extra wiggle with the hips on Dack. I mean, there's no way she can even foul this pitch off because she's so fooled. Such a great job by Willis. She's executing some big pitches in some moments. Pretty special.
Josie Muffley. In the nine spot.
I can say enough about Sarah Willis, Court. Like, I'm impressed of just kind of the demeanor, right? Like, regardless of how long she takes in between pitches, like, to me, it's just being able to command that zone. Runners on, any type of pressure. I mean, she still sticks to her routine, sticks to the roots of what makes her good, calm. And the pop of the mid is there. I mean, 69 miles an hour. You hear it.
Gets her ahead 1-2 on Muffley. Hitting it to Williams. She's immediately going to third. The runner is safe. Runners on the corners.
I'm not sure I'm down with this play. I know it's a hot shot to Jazz Williams, but you also have to remember that Mudge is a righty. She's not a lefty. It's different if she's a lefty with the speed up the line. You have more time. But more importantly, there's a lot of speed with Ross. We just saw her steal that base. You know she's going to get to three. I got to get an out. I go one. That's how I feel about that.
Instead, a huge opportunity for Florida State and the top of the order with Kaylee Mudge. Just one down, runners on the corners. Michaela Edenfield started off this inning with a walk. The fourth ball issued because there was too much time in between pitches. Ross is running for her at third now. Muffley at first on the fielder's choice. Muffley in the scoring position.
Kaylee Mudge, her last at bat, broke up the no-hitter that Sarah Willis was throwing. Pretty hard hit on the changeup up the middle. Opportunity here with a couple big-time base runners in the top of the fifth.
Struck out the first time, made the adjustment, got a single in the fourth inning. Stole the base, scored a run.
Take.
Ball two strikes. State, we've seen them make that adjustment again. Their first nine hitters, 0-for-9, no base runners. Last nine, 2-for-7, 5 base runners.
As I know, the changeup is Sarah Willis's best pitch at a 3-2 count with Kaylee Mudge, who broke up the no-hitter on the change. You remember that. So you wonder where Sarah Willis is going to go. If she could execute that good screwball. Try to force Mudge to hit it to the left side of the infield.
She goes right, the throw goes home, and it's off target. Ross is across, so is Josie Muffley. Knowles in the lead for the first time.
Ultimately, it comes down to clean defense. I actually think this play is going to go to review.
Here they are looking at it. We do have replay review in action. That'll be done in Pittsburgh in a centralized location.
Now obviously, that is a play that is reviewable. This would be... this would be big. Checking to see if Doherty picked up that ball in foul territory. If she does and she grounds it across the line in foul territory, it would be that foul ball.
So we'll give you another look at this.
Look at where the line is and where the ball bounces. She's got 1 foot in fair territory and 1 foot in foul territory. You have to look at where she fields that ball. That's tough. I think it based on where her body's at in the middle of the line and where it looks like she gets it.
I thought it was fair.
Yeah. Yeah. The way that I'm looking at that angle, remember, there has to be enough evidence to really overturn that call.
Here's a great look.
Bird's eye view here. Yeah, I think that's fair.
That's a fair ball. The call's upheld.
If we can't get back in the ball game, we have another game tonight, and we have two games tomorrow if we want to get out of this regional, so it's being smart.
And she cannot re-enter because they pinch ran for her. She hits for herself. They pinch ran for her and then re-entered her already. So she's done for this game. And what a way to, you come in if you're Angelina DeVoe and you start with Janai Kerr, who had a 13-pitch at-bat in the first inning. What have you liked most about the adjustments for Florida State?
I think that they've done a good job at swinging early, but more importantly, like fouling off pitches, having a lot more lengthier ABs. I mean, you saw Sarah Willis in the third inning or second inning, four pitches was all she needed to get out of it.
Yeah, the second inning.
So I think when you start to see those things, having lengthier at-bats, making a pitcher have to throw more pitches, at times they're more susceptible to missing over the white of the plate because it's like, all right, dang, we're going on the eighth pitch, the ninth pitch, the 10th pitch.
The 13th pitch.
Kerr, a 7-minute at-bat to lead off. Like, that was huge, and that's a statement. They're doing a good job of just being scrappy hitters second, third time through.
Two now to Janai Kerr. Player that was a top recruit coming out of high school, then COVID happened, then the next season after that tore her ACL. Only made four appearances in 2021 before that injury. Pop up. Shannon Doherty takes it. Kaylee Mudge out there in scoring position after getting the RBI. Now Kaylee Harding, up to her to bring her around and add to Florida State's lead if she can. First pitch, crushed it. Not deep enough though. Janisha Rowe sprinting over. NFSU will leave one in scoring position.
For the gates.
Yeah. Well, you know. We got two more games to go, so
I know, Danielle. I know.
Buckle up. This has been a great one to start, though. Florida State taking their first lead in the top of this inning. How does UCF respond? You know they love that they have Jada Cody coming up to lead off this inning.
And a lot of ball game left. I mean, they have nine outs left to be able to try to get back in this ball game. You cannot count out this tough offense for UCF, especially right now. So scrappy.
Walked in the third inning her last time up. This one pulled over to Kaylee Harding. You know, talking to Kat Sandercock yesterday, she said, I came in as a freshman, you know, you're used to being the best player.
Yeah.
As a high schooler, and then you're humbled a little bit. And Lonnie Alameda, she was told her, you know, you're a ground ball pitcher, you induce ground outs. And she said, no, I'm a strikeout pitcher. Well, she takes some time, but she's embraced that. She loves it. Trust in that defense. It's been so fun to watch her evolve and come into her own and figure out who she is over these 5 years at Florida State. Hopper to Muffley. Two down.
Well, to just kind of piggyback on what you're saying, I mean, that's what, back-to-back ground balls? That's not to say that she's not going to get the strikeout. Right. And there's a difference between someone telling you, like, your stuff isn't strikeout material. Well, yeah, that's offensive.
Yeah.
I wouldn't like that either, but...
That's not what she was saying.
No, yeah. I know. I've been told someone, when I went back with Canada and Rapsodo, he's like, yeah, your spin rate, you're not going to strike any hitters out. And I had a conversation with Kaylee Rafter about it the other day because Florida State uses Rapsodo like crazy to get spin rate on pitchers. And I love the data. But the data isn't everything. You cannot teach bulldog mentality. You cannot teach the pressure-filled, being able to rise to the occasion. Spin rate has nothing to do with that. That helps out those situations. But I think when you can mix in Sandercock and that beast mode mentality with the fact that she does induce the ground balls, you get a little bit of a strikeout pitcher in there, too.
She has 5 strikeouts today. She said 5 years has been the perfect amount of time.
Yeah, 4 is like too short.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This one right to Keene. 3 up, 3 down. Portion of the bracket, both of these teams, UCF and Florida State, won last night. Courtney Lyle and Danielle Laurie with you from Tallahassee all week. And Mac Leonard is going to lead off the 6th. So we saw a new pitcher enter in the last inning as Florida State started to figure out Sarah Willis. Then they took their first lead, and here for UCF comes Angelina DeVoe. This will be the 3rd batter she's faced.
Pretty polar opposite pitchers when you think about it. DeVoe, and just being that lefty, does not blow you away. Miles per hour, 58 to 60. Throw that off speed a little bit from the left side.
That one coming inside, and it's 3 balls, no strikes to Leonard. Nice pitch.
When this is a Florida State team, when you look up at the scoreboard, I mean, only 2 hits on the day, being out hit by UCF. UCF's found a way to get runners on base with Kat Sandercock. It really just comes down to that little miscue, that error by Doherty at first, that overthrow.
Mac Leonard into the glove of Chloe Evans. Devin Flaherty walked the last time up.
One thing we talked to Coach Lonnie Alameda about with Devin Flaherty, she said she's a kid that's really had to utilize the weight room as of late, especially when you're in season, because in this heat, she's a kid that can drop weight like crazy with just the practicing and the outside and the humidity. She's been working extra hard.
That one into shallow left, finding the grass, Devin Flaherty. And that's the 3rd hit today for Florida State.
It's almost like Flaherty's just a sure double as soon as she gets on base. A lot of stolen bases, 28 stolen bases on the year. Does a good job in the lefty-lefty matchup, hitting the curveball away. Hitting it where it's pitched. Wouldn't be surprised here. You see her stealing.
a pitch or two.
Hallie Waycaser following her up. First pitch towards Lee, who has taken over at third, but that will move Flaherty. Just like that, Michaela Enfield back up. Singing along with her walk-up song.
I mean, this if that's her true walk-up song, she's got a fan up here in the booth.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Michaela Enfield, I can't imagine what this season has been like for her. Catching, I mean, Florida State's used seven different pitchers. They have four pitchers who have 40 or more innings pitched on the season. Catching them, getting to know them, also making sure that she's ready to go with her bat.
I think it's her greatest gift, aka strength, as a catcher is how well she is able to connect with each pitcher. I mean, trying to pretty much date seven different pitchers at one time and get to know them and what works for them. What works for Catherine Sandercog may not work for McKenna Reed or DeBoe. There's just so much that goes into that relationship and building that and building trust. And also taking on that responsibility of what it's like when she steps in the box. I mean, she's got a big responsibility with a lot of pop. I mean, she leads this team in RBI. She had a heck of a year last year, so she probably had that little layer of pressure heading into this year, but you never see her carry an at-bat onto the field to play for defense.
And remember, too, she redshirted in 2021. Because of COVID, they found a heart murmur. She's able to come back, and then last year a top 10 finalist for the National Freshman of the Year.
I think sometimes when you take the game away, it really gives perspective to the athlete of how much they love it, how much they want to work, and glad they caught what they caught and were able to get her back. She's been thriving ever since.
And it's back to what back walks for her. She walked in the fifth, and now she'll walk here in the sixth inning. Bethany Keene up at the plate. Two out, two on.
And Florida State, 1-for-9 with runners in scoring position on the day.
This one hops past DeVoe. Jasmine Williams still able to make the play from short to get out of the inning. Charged on that ball. Very efficient inning in the fifth for Kat Sandercock. Seven pitches, three ground outs, and Shannon Doherty starts off here in the sixth. First pitch strikes to 22 batters face for Kat Sandercock.
Here for that.
Yeah, here all day.
We are here all day. I mean, no one, come on, you love getting to hang with me for like 12 hours.
And Sandercock ahead, 0-2. This one will take its time getting to Harding. And Doherty retired.
Right now, UCF has to find a way to string some things together. This is a team that's fiery. They play on momentum. Someone has to create that, whether it's a big hit or someone getting someone in the dugout going. But last night, they were all about it, dancing, having fun, just a different look when you take a peek in the dugout now.
Can Jasmine Williams be that fire?
Sandercock just continue to go on how efficient she's gotten, especially as of late. I mean, her pitch count has just gone down hitter to hitter. The last five batters, five pitches, three pitches, two pitches, two pitches, three. And that's what it's all about. That just goes to show and link up with what you said an inning ago about her being that ground ball pitcher and not always needing to go for the strikeout, using the defense. Pitchers would much rather throw less and have a smaller pitch count if it means they can get back in the dugout and take a seat, take a rest. Give your defense a little bit of action, keeps them happy too.
It indeed was K-time for the sixth time.
And these are the pitches you got to be able to lay off. You just look at that true rotation. Such pretty spin on the drop ball. Hard pitch to do anything with.
This is Emerson Lee, her first look at Catherine Sandercock. Batting in the seventh spot where Olivia Elliott was, the DP today, who had a walk and a hit. Cat Sandercock quickly 0-2.
And it's almost like she knows what's at stake, right? And we talked to her about when she's come into games, when the pressure's there. At times she'd had to remind herself because she'd been thinking, man, this is what it's going to feel like when I strike out this hitter and we all run in. And she said, I have to get more present, more kind of in my zone, just execute the pitch and not try to overthink. But you just look at where she's been at here in the sixth inning. Such a great job of not having to throw a lot of pitches, but being efficient.
This is the 11th time she started a batter 0-2.
The numbers don't lie. Jeff Muir, you know?
Dishing them to us constantly. I love it.
I'll take no credit for when I throw a number out there. It's all Jeff.
The Edenfield's shin guard popped off, so she restrapped it and ready to go. Off of Sandra Clock's glove, trying to toss it. No. Lee is going to beat it out.
You see the volunteer, Kaylee Rafter, making her way. Travis Wilson to just go and take another peek at this play for the review. Ooh, that was close. She bare hands it. This should be the good angle. Does it get in the hand before the foot? Oh, I think the foot gets there. Remember, there has to be enough evidence that you see. And I think I see the foot go down. I like the challenge. Why not? But I think the right call was made.
And remember, starting in the bottom of the sixth inning, the umpires can initiate review.
Oh, that was so close.
That's a great look at it.
Yeah. And let's not forget, how slow-mo is this? And we're still like,
Look right there. Watch this.
Oh. But to the naked eye, Courtney, that is a tough call.
It's almost simultaneous.
The tie goes to the runner, you're saying?
We'll see.
I think we'll see.
They uphold this call.
Well, you know what this does? This brings a tying run to the plate. Sarah Willis. Sarah Willis, 4 home runs on the year. Has some pop behind the bat.
And I'm seeing what they did now with the lineup. They used the DP flex to keep Sarah Willis in there so she could go back to the circle and pitch.
Yep, and I just flexed on you because I'm with you. She's someone that, say you get back in this ball game, you want to make sure you can't lose her. And you think, hey, they did substitute in a pinch runner. Potentially she burned. But if you use that flex to your advantage, it allows for her to stay in the game and keep hitting and potentially have to go back out there and pitch if need be. I don't know if you got, like, intimidated there when I flexed. I think
I mean,
for a second
always,
you did.
Yes.
But I'm fine with it. You didn't really say much, but
speechless.
That's what most say.
12th time that Kat Sandercock has started 0-2. Harding waving everyone off, and she grabs it. We are going to the 7th inning. Florida State up by 2.
Because they would meet the winner of that regional.
Interesting note, at the SEC tournament last week, we talked to Tony Baldwin, Georgia's head coach, and he said, when we go one and done in the SEC tournament the last few years, we go to the Women's College World Series.
Oh, Nugget
and
Central.
They did. They lost their first game at the SEC tournament.
I was surprised. Auburn was on a hot streak.
Yeah.
Or not Auburn, South Carolina.
South Carolina,
excuse me,
yeah.
Was on a hot streak. But when you look at Georgia and just obviously that Shelby Walters, the transfer from Duke for them, has really helped them in the circle.
Josie Muffley is hit to start the 7th. That flips the order.
So to me, on paper, is this a team that I think can definitely get there talent-wise? Yes. The hard part about the postseason is things happen all the time. It's the beauty of having a win. We shall see.
But you got to win, too. It's double elimination every round, so it'll reset when we go to Supers next week. Best 2 out of 3 series between 2 teams. It is wild after this weekend. I know you said this. Then we go down to 16 teams.
Yeah,
it's like, whoa.
You take a lot out, and that's why it's when you get to talk to the athletes and you just hear how much these moments mean to them. Talking to Marist yesterday or 2 days ago, excuse me, and them just saying how excited they are for this opportunity. It's the first time that whole team has gotten to experience this.
And Marist's first appearance since 2016. Here's Mudge. We'll see Marist coming up in our next game. It'll be here on ESPN Plus for you. 35 minutes after this one finishes.
Importance for UCF, try to have a good, quick inning. It's all about the momentum. Like I said, this is a team that plays well and feeds well off of energy. They have to find a way to create some. Because to me, they've looked a little flat over the last couple innings, not their typical self. They want to try to make a comeback here in the bottom of the seventh. Someone has to get them going, and it can't just be a rally cap. It has to be a conversation from one teammate to the rest of the team, or something that's going to get him going.
There goes Mudge. Got her. Jada Cody throwing behind the plate. And they're going to look at it. Video replay coming. Ooh. No,
hands.
She's safe.
Yeah, she is.
Yep, right there, her hand clearly beats the throw.
Seems like a good amount of evidence to me when I see it.
Yeah. No, it's clear from the angles that we have. They're looking at a department out there supporting Josie Muffley, who volunteers with them, does ride-alongs. Kaylee Mudge bouncing it off the wall. Muffley speeding home thanks to Mudge. Two RBI on the day for Kaylee.
Florida State tacking on some more insurance runs. Kaylee Mudge takes this curveball. Does a really good job, pretty swing. Dead center, I thought, hey, maybe this is gonna go out of here. Warning track all day. Things working in Florida State's favor.
And a new pitcher in the circle now for UCF. Grace Jewell coming into the circle. Third pitcher of the day for the Knights. They need to get three outs and get to the bottom of the seventh inning because they've got some work to do offensively.
And I don't mind this change for a couple reasons. Number one, damage control. You don't need any more runs up on the board if you want to try to get back in it. But number two, given her experience of what it feels like to be out here, to be pitching, understanding that if UCF does not win, they're going to have to go through the winner of South Carolina Marist tonight, and then they're going to have to beat Florida State twice tomorrow. So to get pitchers some reps to feel things is important. She's really worked on the velo. Has that good changeup, will spin and throw that fastball on both corners, and a good opportunity here for her to get her feet wet and try to get her team back in the dugout.
And she has the second most innings pitched on this staff for UCF next to Sarah Willis. 121 and a third innings on the season. She has the lowest opponent batting average on the staff at 180. She's going to start with the number two hitter, Janai Kerr, and a runner in scoring position. If Kaylee Mudge's bat, by the way, 20th straight game that Florida State has had a double.
That's why they lead the nation.
If you weren't with us 12 hours ago when we started this game, Janai Kerr had a 13-pitch at bat.
That was a while ago, huh?
It's been about, we're approaching three-hour mark.
You know, for all, everyone tuning in right now, when my partner gets a little hangry, she's getting to that point. She's getting a little hungry. We are going on almost 3 hours here. So once we get some food with the 35 minutes, I mean, game changer. She's not laughing at my jokes like she normally does. So it's a marathon, not a sprint.
It is. I know, that's why we brought food. 0-2 now. Grace Jewell coming in.
And no one better touch that food in the fridge with our name on it.
Well, that's why we wrote our name on it with the Sharpie.
Game over.
Reach for it. This one goes back to Jewell. And Mudge moves over to third. Now we're being taunted.
God, that looks good. Dan. I'd literally be just taking the ones that look really yellow. So there's that.
You're that person?
Have you ever had the lesser evil popcorn?
No.
Oh, wow. And we're like supposed to be tight, you and me. Literally,
apparently we're not anymore.
Oh my God, there's nothing like lesser evil popcorn. Himalayan salt. Jeez, you gotta have a flosser, but
this is not an ad.
No, it is not.
Kaylee Harding got her hit in the fourth inning off of Sarah Willis.
Different note, digging the pinstripes for UCF.
Oh yeah,
solid unis,
very solid.
And I mean, statement wearing black unis on a hot day too.
They're used to it there.
They are.
You know what we've seen from Florida State's hitters the last 2 days is how good they are at making adjustments. They figure out that first time through. They pass the bat so well. We've seen them about the third or fourth inning, both of these games, really change, figure it out, even with different pitchers coming in.
And I think a lot of confidence behind that. There's no, oh man, we're not scoring or we haven't got a hit yet.
It's a fair ball. Lee trying to throw home. Off target, looking for Jada Cody, a run scores.
Ultimately, it comes down to defense, and UCF has not been sharp.
Look at the throw, look at the angle, completely off target. Listen, pressure is a privilege. In these types of moments, defense needs to be able to step up and make good plays. I think Mudge has a lot of speed, so I think even if the throw's on the money, there's a good chance that Mudge is going to score. I gotta get outs.
This is Flaherty, and Harding's gonna hold at second. Harding reaching on the fielder's choice, advancing to second on the error, does get the RBI. 2 errors today for UCF. That one comes in on Mac Leonard for strike one. Still the third pitcher that we've seen from UCF today. Sarah Willis getting the start. Angelina DeVoe relieved her in the fifth. And then Grace Jewell has come in here in the seventh inning. This is the third batter she's faced. And strikes out Mac Leonard. Two down. Well, the Gamecocks out in the grass watching on. They're getting set to play an elimination game against Marist that is coming up 35 minutes after this game finishes.
I spy an Uncrustable. A couple of them. Staple. Ooh. In the kids' lunches.
I spy some pistachios.
Yeah. I know. Tell everyone we're hungry without telling them we're hungry.
No, you told them. There's no secrets here. Now Devin Flaherty up. This inning started with a Josie Muffley being hit by a pitch. Then Kaylee Mudge following that up with an RBI double. She would come around thanks to the RBI and an error when Kaylee Harding was batting. Jewel ahead of Devin Flaherty, 0-2. Back-to-back K's for Grace Jewel. And now UCF will have the 9-1 and 2 hitters up. The last chance for the Knights at 4 Eastern. We still have 2 games on deck for you today here from Tallahassee. And Janisha Rowe leading it off. UCF with 3 outs to work with.
Defense has to be on their toes with her in the 9 spot. We've seen her drop the bunt earlier today and just deaden it out in front, leg it out for an easy base hit.
She's got 2 hits on the day, 2 for 2. Came in her last 12 games hitting .407.
Kat Sandercock, just even prior to this inning beginning, 87 pitches on the day, 67 of those are strikes. That's 78% of the time she is getting ahead of these hitters. And once you get ahead, that's when it allows for you to go to all the other things that make you great, toy with the hitter a little bit.
This one to Flaherty, and Rowe is retired. Kennedy Searcy coming up for the fourth time. She has struck out twice against Kat Sandercock. Excuse me, we're going to have a pinch hitter. Katie Burge is going to step in that top of the order spot. Last six games for Katie Burge, 333. Saw her last night, but only in a pinch running role. Hitting 362 against right-handed pitchers. That one passed Flaherty out to Waycaser. Called on to pinch hit, and she gets on. So one down, Burge on first for Jada Cody. Cody grounded out to third last time up in the fifth inning. Reached once today, that was via the walk in the third.
Great spot by Sandercock. Still doing a great job locating that drop. Low in the zone, hitting the bottom half.
Whoa!
And she really hasn't needed to use that pitch much. I can count on one hand how many changeups Sandercock has had to throw today, but the fact that she can just whip it out when it hasn't been thrown, get the big swing and miss.
Now you got the hitters thinking, is it coming again?
Hey, you're talking like me.
Digging deep is Jada Cody, rolling it to left. Back-to-back hits for the Knights. And out comes Lonnie Alameda. You see McKenna Reed working in the pen right now for Florida State.
Leaving Sandercock out there, let her grind through this. It's not like her pitch count is really, really high, only 95 so far. A little bit of pressure.
And look at her pitches by inning. She's done a really nice job today, been ahead most of the time. This is Aubrey Evans after back-to-back singles. Burge and Cody aboard. 1-1 to Evans. Hopper, Flaherty takes it, looking for two. Safe! Aubrey Evans beats it.
Flaherty stunned.
It is a play they could go look at, but they will not hear.
Twelve double plays on the year for Florida State, and oh, it was close.
And Catherine Sandercock leaving the circle right now for Florida State. Here comes McKenna Reed. And you see Sandercock stay. 6 2/3 innings, 8 hits. Just one earned run given up, and she struck out 6.
98 pitches on the day. 76 of those strikes. It's a good day.
Keep in mind, too, this whole pitching staff for Florida State, they have trained for this to come in. We need you to get one out. With runners on the corners, bases loaded, whatever the situation is, this is not a new thing. McKenna Reed being asked to come in.
When battle tested, Coach Lonnie Alameda talked about McKenna Reed getting the start in a Duke series and how important it was to get those feels under her belt. She is a lefty. Compliments Sandercock so well. She spins it, she throws it hard, 60 to 70 miles an hour. Really fun athlete to watch. I mean, great numbers on the year. And I like bringing her in this situation, too.
And she starts with Chloe Evans, who has 2 hits off of Sandercock. So now a different look to face McKenna Reed for the first time. Another look at this double play attempt.
Oh man, we've seen just the closest of close. That
wow.
I literally
oh
I solid job by the camera crew. I mean,
it's a heck of a look.
Getting the good angles.
All right, 2 outs, runners on the corners, and Chloe Evans up to the plate to face McKenna Reed. Edenfield taking it, and Evans beats the throw. Bases juiced. The tying run coming to the plate.
Opportunity here for Doherty. 9 home runs on the year. Bring the tying run to the dish.
Now she's their leading home run hitter. First one, liked it. Not deep enough. Janai Kerr is there and the threat is over. Florida State moving on to the regional final. An 18th straight win for the Seminoles. And that ends the win streak for UCF.
And a loyal fan following. Everyone here supporting the Noles.
has to feel good to get that win heading into Sunday, where you have to get beat twice. This was a hard-fought battle by both these teams. I mean, UCF found a way to get hits today. I mean, they out-hit Florida State, but a couple of errors didn't play in their favor and put them in a tough spot, and Florida State –